Okay, before we move towards the highlight of this symposium, being the lecture by Professor Zatopoulos himself, I would like to give a short transitional lecture. So we had quite some topical lectures, very interesting lectures today. And this will be something in between of a lecture and some reflections, and actually also introducing the final talk by Professor Zatopoulos. So I would like to start with a major disclaimer. This is a short presentation, and the title that I put here, actually I decided on that title quite some time ago, and then yesterday evening at 12, well, almost 12 o'clock at night, I decided to start working on my presentation, and then it appeared to be quite ambitious. So I would like to start with a major disclaimer. So this presentation will certainly not be complete. There's a lot of wind engineering research being done in other departments as well. Department of Applied Physics, Department of Mathematics, Department of Mechanical Engineering. I will only focus on wind engineering in the built environment, and then only, even then, a very small selection. I would like to start with a question, and I know that some of you have seen this before, and I will promise you this will be the last time that I bother you with this. But I think also some of you did not see this yet. So what you're looking at here is a top view of two high-rise buildings in V-shape, converging arrangement, diverging arrangement. And the question actually is, for this very simple building configuration, a very simple flow you might expect here, in which passage do you get the highest wind speed? Is that in passage A of the converging arrangement or passage B, sorry, of the diverging arrangement? So I can tell you, the first time I asked this on a wind engineering conference, 95% of the audience voted for A. But by now, I've been showing this so many years that many of you probably will know that, of course, I would not ask the question if it was a straightforward solution. Please hold on to your answer. We'll come back to that later on. Past research in built environment wind engineering at Eindhoven University, there's a lot to talk about. So I'm just, again, going to make a very brief selection. This, when I started as a PhD student, was the first thesis I read completely. Marcel Bottema, Wind Climate and Urban Geometry, and this is really a very nice piece of work. It's very complete. At that time, performing intensive CFD simulations with the computational power limitations was quite a challenge. So this is really an excellent thesis to stand. I can actually recommend it to anyone interested in pedestrian level wind conditions. Then later on was another excellent thesis. Chris Geurts, also present here today, sitting there in the back, not paying very much attention, I see. But he wrote this excellent thesis, mainly comparing wind tunnel measurements and full-scale measurements. So the full-scale measurements were made on the campus, and the wind tunnel measurements, because the university did not or does not have an atmospheric boundary layer wind tunnel, were made at another location. Then there's Fabian van Molk. In 2003, he defended his PhD thesis on wind-driven rain. Fabian is also here today. Also a very pioneering thesis, and actually inspired a lot of work in around the world afterwards. And then there is the thesis of Gabor Desseux, was a collaboration between the Department of Architecture, Building and Planning, as it was called then, and the Von Karman Institute, Jeroen van Beek. And Professor van Beek explained us before that he is a big fan of sand erosion experiments, and here actually he had a PhD student doing nothing else for 4 years than sand erosion experiments, and trying to link the sand erosion to quantitative measures, which actually they were quite successful at. So let's look a bit at what has been going on in the past or the recent years. So present research, again, I'm just going to make a small selection. This is a presentation that you just saw, I think about half an hour ago. This was a double doctorate, and I have to say that I've been very lucky as a starting researcher here at Eindhoven University to be blessed with excellent PhD students, and Don was one of the first. He also graduated here cum laude at Eindhoven University, was also double doctorate with Leuven University, was also collaboration with ETH Zurich, also with the Department of Applied Physics, so you see a lot of names mentioned here. Sometimes you just get very, very lucky. I was traveling by train from Utrecht to Eindhoven, and suddenly I get an email from a very nice lady that I never met before, and she said, well, I would like to come to Eindhoven University and do a PhD thesis with you, and if possible in double degree between my university, Politecnico di Milano, and Eindhoven University. And well, then I invited her to come to Eindhoven one day. So she arrived at Eindhoven Airport, we had a short meeting, and then it became clear that this was really an excellent candidate. So she graduated also recently, well, 2014, and she got the cum laude award at Politecnico di Milano. So it was also an excellent thesis. So another example, this is Hamid Montazeri, he's about to defend. This is a collaboration between Jan Hansen and myself, but in the larger climate-proof cities project that actually grouped a large number of universities and research institutes among the Netherlands. And Hamid is also actually an indication of how lucky we are with many of our excellent PhD students. So he will graduate based on 8 ISI journal papers that he wrote. And he's a PhD student himself, but he's already supervising for other PhD students, which is really remarkable. The list goes on, so I will not continue, I will not mention everybody, because Twan also mentioned some people already. Wendy is actually performing a project where she's combining basic research on atmospheric boundary layer behavior over heterogeneous rough terrain with a very practical application. And I think there's a month goes by when the Port of Rotterdam is not asking Wendy for questions on her model and how to maneuver ships safely into the harbor at higher wind speeds than was possible before. And then there's Yassin. So there's a white spot here. I will fill that up later. So it is a collaboration with Vito, also with the Department of Applied Physics, and he's looking at modeling of the urban heat island effect and the effects of that on indoor environment. And I think he does that for maybe 40 to 15 hours, 50 hours a week. And the rest of the week, I think he has a bit of strange, well, the same strange habit as his first supervisor. The rest of the week, he studies cycling aerodynamics. And I see Professor Baker smiling at the row because he will, of course, make the comment, where are the bicycles? We're working on that. They will be added later on. And this is the last example I will show, because these are all PG projects that are quite advanced already in terms of time, but also in terms of results. And this is actually a study of, well, what you see here is a plain turbulent jet, Reynolds number about 6,000, impinging here on a flat plate. And we study that actually because we want to know more about air curtains that you have at the entrance of shops and so on. But it's also a very nice fundamental research question, and that's also a reason why we also here collaborate with the Department of Applied Physics. There is quite a strong misunderstanding that, and I think that's a misunderstanding that is a bit characteristic I think the Netherlands in general, because the Netherlands is really a very good country to work in, but there are some misconceptions. And one misconception is that in building physics, or in our department, Department of the Built Environment, we only do applied research. I can tell you this is certainly not true. So I would like to show a little bit of the fundamental research, briefly, that we did and are doing. And Jan Carmeliet already mentioned this work, that actually we have been focusing on actually how you from consistency of these simulations, meaning simulations where you can actually match all parameters together, you match inlet profiles, you match the wall functions, you match the computational grid, the turbulence model constants, and so on, in order to get boundary layer flow that you want to achieve. And this is fundamental research. The nice thing about fundamental research, apart from that it's really a lot of fun, is that sometimes, and this was a bit unexpected, this kind of papers can get a lot of citations. So that was a nice side effect of this work. But we also focus on grid generation techniques that we also apply to basic and applied case studies. Ton already showed this here, the Amsterdam Arena Stadium. But the real champion of the Dutch competition is actually playing here. This is the PSV football stadium. Here you see Eindhoven City Center, where we'll have dinner later on. And here is actually where Eindhoven University starts, the campus, starts the science park. So these grids are not made automatically, they're made semi-automatically, and we control the quality and the size of every cell. We do not have any tetrahedral cell, so that means you can apply higher order discretization schemes, even for this kind of rather complex geometries, and still get very good accurate results and excellent convergence behavior. And this is the campus. Well, this was the campus. Now we're developing towards a science park, and of course, many buildings are being changed and redeveloped or reconstructed. But this is also an example of complex computational grids that are made for, in this case, pedestrian level wind comfort studies. And this is part of the very large Port of Rotterdam. This is the cruise terminal, where we also did a study on what the effect, of what kinds of effect, so, what kind, sorry, effects a ship has, a cruise ship, when it actually sails into the harbor. Because, of course, the buildings have an effect on each other, but this is maybe it's not the highest, but it's definitely the widest kind of building that you can imagine here. And of course, the buildings have an effect, wind effects on the ship, but also vice versa. And the Port of Rotterdam wanted to know what is really going on there and what will happen. And that actually was the largest cruise ship in the world, MS Oasis of the Seas, that came last year to the Port of Rotterdam. And everything went safely. Of course, the wind speed was not that high, but still, I think the simulations were quite useful for that. And then you might wonder, application of these developments for new and improved insights in basic flow problems. And wind engineering research has been going on for a very long time. Boundary layer wind tunnels exist since the 60s. Many wind tunnels have been built, many studies have been made, CFD simulations have been made. So you wonder, what is still to investigate? Don't we know everything already? Well, and that's why I asked you this question. This is actually a ridiculously simple example, or at least a ridiculously simple building configuration. And here you might wonder, well, maybe here you get the highest amplification, because what people often say is, well, you will have a Venturi effect. The question is this really true? And that's why I put this kind of provocative quote at the top. Is it fact or is it fiction, this Venturi effect? So if you want to, of course, know of make a statement about the Venturi effect, you have to go back and see what Giovanni Battista Venturi really investigated himself. And what he investigated, and I admit this is a very simplified drawing, he investigated flow in closed channels, so confined flows. And that's completely different from the open flows in wind engineering, because there's of course no law in physics that says that all of this flow has to go through this narrow passage. So that was interesting to investigate that, certainly because this statement on Venturi effect is really used a lot in practice, building engineering practice. So we were actually very much intrigued to find out what, to what extent this effect would be acting or not. So this is Venturi, and this is his book. And well, it took me quite a while to get this book. So this book was at the Niels Bohr Library in the American Institute of Physics. And I mailed them when I was a PhD student at that time, and I asked them if they could send me a copy of that book. And they said, no way. This book is actually in a glass cabinet, and if we take it out, it actually falls apart. It's really the original ancient book. So I kind of, well, I was still patient at that time, so I kind of tried to be persistent, and finally the lady sent me an email with a large PDF file, and she actually had scanned the whole book for me. So if you are interested in this book, I have the PDF. It's really fantastic. So it's written in French, but it's written in ancient French, so my French is not good. My ancient French is even worse. So this was tough, this is tough reading material, but even the graphs themselves are already like piece, it's a piece of art. So really good. And then back to Montreal, back to Tessatopoulos, where we made this ridiculously simple building models, just wooden blocks, carefully sawed, put them in the wind tunnel, and we measured wind speed for these configurations, for different orientations and so on. And at some point we tried to publish that at a conference also held in Montreal, by the way, and we got three reviews. One review was very positive, one was actually quite negative. He said, well, this is not possible, Venturi effect has to act here, and you say that it's not present. And the other review was actually very negative, and he said, yeah, you're really like the heretics of fluid mechanics, so the paper was rejected. Luckily, the chair of the conference had his office next to mine, so I started talking to him and explained the situation, and then finally it was accepted. But later on, we published it in several journals, and actually got very positive comments on this work. So what is actually going on? And that's what you see here. This is a large eddy simulation of the flow in these configurations. You see the wind speed, well, meta-mensual is indicated here. In this case, you see, and I will try to start it again, you see actually a large mass of stagnant air. And the oncoming wind actually is not going to force itself through this way, through this large mass of almost stagnant air with overpressure. It actually follows the way of least resistance, and that's just what comes out of the governing equations. While here, this is completely different, so I will try to start it again. Here you see the large wind speeds are outside the buildings, not in the passage. Here you see they are in the passage. So actually what happens here is, yeah, you can call it subsonic upstream disturbance, because if you have flow below the speed of sound, your governing equations are elliptic. That means what happens here is determining what happens here. So you have upstream disturbance, and that exactly is what is going on here. So then you might wonder, oh nice, some fundamental research, but maybe totally irrelevant because nobody puts buildings like that, right? Well, it's not completely true. Well, this is a drawing we made, I will skip that. There is a building that actually is very much oriented or built like that. And that's Bahrain World Trade Center, where actually we're, based on this fundamental study, we're intrigued, like how much, because it's oriented in converging arrangement, how much more energy would these turbines yield if we would just turn the building 180 degrees around, which would cost €0 more than it has been built now. So we did measurements. I think one of the last measurements that was still done in the former TNO wind tunnel, did the CFD simulations and so on. And we could show that if you would turn the towers 180 degrees around, you get 14% more wind energy per year, which is quite a lot and quite remarkable. Okay, to go towards a conclusion about the future, well, there are three main assessment techniques in wind engineering, and of course you all know that, your on-site measurements is probably the oldest, and wind tunnel measurements, atmospheric boundary layer wind tunnels, started around the 60s, then computational fluid dynamics in wind engineering also started around that time, very gradually, and this is actually, yeah, it's called sometimes the trio, the golden trio of wind engineering, wind assessment. And actually what we do in, or did in Eindhoven, is a lot on-site measurements, a lot of CFD, and for the wind tunnel measurements, we either try to collect a large amount of money to go to a commercial wind tunnel, or we try to get into a wind tunnel of some of our colleagues in other countries. And of course, if you want to do a PhD research and you have to do a test many times again, and you need to actually live in a wind tunnel for a few weeks, this is really not feasible. And that's why we are designing now an atmospheric boundary layer wind tunnel to be built here on campus. And there's actually a few good reasons for that, because some people, well, many people actually have congratulated us with this plan, and actually some people have also asked questions like, why do we need another wind tunnel, because Netherlands has like now two. Okay, Netherlands had three, then the TNO wind tunnel was abandoned, so it has two now, and with this one there will be again three, but why do we need that? Well, the Netherlands is one of the only countries in Europe that has no university with atmospheric boundary layer wind tunnel. And that's quite remarkable if you see that in the countries surrounding us, and especially countries where politicians in the Netherlands like to compare them with, like Switzerland, Scandinavian countries and so on, they're continuously building new wind tunnels there and upgrading existing tunnels to keep up to date with the state of the art. We have two very good atmospheric boundary layer wind tunnels in the Netherlands, but I can tell you I spent last year about €80,000 to do tests in some of those wind tunnels. And then at some point, it's too expensive to do, or to let alone to have PG students working in those tunnels and to allow some trial and error. We have many very good students here, and they do some fantastic projects like Solar Challenge, the Storm Motorbike and so on. They actually won the cruiser class last year in the Solar Challenge in Australia. And they actually have been asking already several times to be able to test their design in the atmospheric boundary layer windtunnel or in a windtunnel. Now, actually, for this year, we made an agreement with our good friend Jeroen van Beek from the Von Karman Institute, where actually the students for this year can measure almost for free, which is really very much appreciated. But of course, as a university, we also want to attract very good international researchers. We want to attract more international students. And then having this type of facility is just absolutely very important, but also would be a great asset. And synergy, of course. You can, of course, not have synergy with other wind tunnels if you don't have a wind tunnel yourself. So let's go to acknowledgements. And then I will pass the word on to Professor Satopoulos. I will go very fast through the acknowledgements, because most of you know that I try to, well, I have the tendency of being very exhaustive in acknowledgements. Well, I would like to thank, of course, first our honorary doctor. I joined his group in Montreal in 2004. And that was really a fantastic experience. We did a lot of work together. I also want to thank my mentors in building physics and in wind engineering. I would like to start with Professor Carmelit. So, as he mentioned before, I was his first PhD student, and if you are the first PhD student of an excellent supervisor, you get a lot of supervision. So I was really lucky to be trained in a very good way. And then in 2004, I defended my thesis, and well, Jan and me were actually publishing quite a lot of papers, doing well, quite a lot of intensive collaboration together. And then I got a grant from the Research Fund Flanders, a postdoctoral grant for 3 years. So life was actually was looking good. I was settled in Leuven. I had a lot of social activities there, road cycling, football, you name it. And then Jan came into my office and he said, Bert, you have to go to Canada for 12 months. What he didn't tell me is that Montreal has 7 months of winter, has 3 weeks at minus 30, and for a road cyclist, this is quite dramatic. But he can be quite persuasive, and of course, he knew Ted. Well, we didn't know Ted Satopoulos very well, but we knew, of course, about his work. And actually, looking back, this has really been a fantastic decision. And it was also very nice of Jan, very altruistic, because actually he sent at that time his most productive collaborator away to work 1 year at a foreign university. I would also like to thank Professor Hugo Hens, who will also be in the cortege tomorrow. He's actually the one that recruited me at Leuven University from the batch of master students. And then, well, you've seen that we have quite a lot of collaboration with Professor Hensen and Professor Van Heist. And, well, I think there's a lot of things that are really fun in academics. But I think really the nicest thing is to work with fantastic people. And, well, I've been showing some photographs of such fantastic colleagues. So that's really nice. I would also like to thank, and I'm going to speed up because otherwise I will keep going on. But the reason why the wind engineering community is so organized is that Professor Solari and later on Professor Tamura have actually spent an enormous amount of effort and time to actually group all those countries, all those research groups together in the International Association of Wind Engineering, which now has actually become quite a strong, very powerful and prestigious organization with its own journal, with its own awards, and so on. And then I would not like to conclude, of course, these acknowledgements without thanking people that have actually done fantastic work here at Eindhoven University in wind engineering, that also founded the Dutch-Flemish Wind Engineering Association, which then got us into the International Association. So that's really also very much appreciated. So, and actually, none of us would be here today. Well, maybe I would be, but I think none of you would be here if we would not have this honorary doctorate tomorrow. And I think, yeah, I really want to thank the executive board of Eindhoven University also for supporting this idea and for all their support for this honorary doctorate and honorary ceremony. So because for us, I think it's really, it's an exceptional honor to have Professor Satopoulos as our honorary doctor. But we're sure that also for him, it is an honor to get this from Eindhoven University, by the way, the only university where he ever had a sabbatical in the past. And also the Department Board of the Built Environment, I would like to thank them wholeheartedly for their support. And then finally, last but not least, I thank the stars, and that are the stars of the urban physics team, and the wind engineering team, and that are, of course, postdoctoral fellows, but also PhD students. And there are actually too many to put on one page, and that actually also means that I do not spend as much time for them as I would like to, but we have assistant, associate professor, postdoctoral fellows that do excellent work, but yeah, I think they certainly know that I appreciate their work very much and that they're really very important for the team. Last slide. Very important, please note the date. This promises to be an excellent conference, and our good friend from Liège, Vincent de Noël, is here today. And he asked me to advertise this symposium. So we meet certainly, I think, in 2017 in Liège, Belgium, in the beginning of summer. Thank you very much.